and welcome to the last part of this unit where we discuss about the hydrogen storage technology. We will conclude with some concepts about the hydrogen transport and distribution option. Let's see what are the options for hydrogen transport and distribution. If hydrogen is to become a fundamental energy vector, it is necessary to develop and build infrastructure for its transport and supply. The method by which hydrogen is produced affects the form of supply and its cost. Indeed, distributed production at consumption points, such as refueling stations or stationary power plants, eliminates the cost of supplying hydrogen. On the contrary, centralized production in large plants requires long-distance transport. This increases supply cost, although it must be analyzed together with the production cost, since this is lower as a result of economies of scale. Transport can be done by pipelines or by vehicles such as road vehicles, ships, trains or airplanes. Consideration can be also given to transport of chemical vectors, or in other words, the substances in whose composition substantial quantities of hydrogen exist, such as, for example, ethanol or ammonia. The transport of these chemical vectors are easier. However, they require appropriate conversion system to be placed at the point of arrival for the production of such hydrogen. As we have mentioned before, hydrogen is a gas with a low volumetric density at standard temperatures and pressures. For this reason, it is convenient to increase its volumetric density when it is transported and distributed. The two most common forms are compression and liquefaction, and both processes require energy. The energy required for compression is equivalent to about 2 and 3% of the lower calorific value of hydrogen. On the other hand, the liquefaction process needs about 11 kWh per kilogram, which is equivalent to 33% of energy contained in hydrogen. However, high-pressure hydrogen storage tanks are usually more expensive than liquid hydrogen tanks. The first option to transport hydrogen is through pipelines. There are close to 5,000 kilometers of hydrogen pipelines around the world today, compared with around 3 million kilometers of natural gas transmission pipelines. These existing hydrogen pipelines are operated by industrial hydrogen producers, and they are mainly used to deliver hydrogen to chemical and refinery facilities. Pipeline supply has the advantages of very low operating costs, which comprise mainly the energy cost and maintenance required by the compressor. The compression energy required in pipeline transport varies in the range of 0.7 and 1 kWh per kilogram. However, such infrastructure has a high capital investment. This infrastructure faces not only economic issues, but also technical issues related to the prevention of hydrogen leakage by permeation or leakage through welding lines. Moreover, there is a need for cheaper and more reliable hydrogen compression technologies, given that the energy required to pump hydrogen gas is approximately 4.5 times greater than that needed for natural gas per unit of energy supply. On the other hand, the problems arising from increased propulsion and increased material degradation are technically solvable, being the safety criteria for pipeline transport of hydrogen more stringent compared to those of natural gas. One possibility for a rapid expansion of the hydrogen distribution infrastructure is the adaptation of part of the natural gas supply network. Converting natural gas pipelines to carry mixtures of natural gas and up to 20% of hydrogen could require only slight modifications. However, to deliver pure hydrogen, the changes will be more important. Existing national regulations for gas quality are defined for the gas value chain in order to cope with blending. As we can see in the figure, many regions specify a maximum of 2% blending, with a few specifying between 4 and 6%. Since natural gas is internationally traded, harmonizing blend limits across borders is a crucial step to support deployment. Liquid hydrogen can also be transported by pipeline. However, liquid hydrogen pipelines have been achieved only with very short distances, as they require careful insulation in order to maintain cryogenic temperature and prevent the formation of double-phase liquid gas. Another option to transport hydrogen is with a vehicle. The transport of gaseous hydrogen in pressurized bottle is an option for the transport by road of moderate quantities over moderate distances. For distances of more than 300 km, the transport of liquid hydrogen is usually chosen, since the high cost of the liquefaction process is compensated by a higher energy density. On the other hand, for larger quantities, it is quite common to transport it in cryogenic tanks by rail or ship and then vaporize it at the actual point of consumption. Hydrogen gas transport by road can be done by using two trailers, as we can see here in the figure on the top. If hydrogen is transported as gas, it must be compressed at very high pressure in order to optimize the capacity of the containers. High-pressure cylinders operate at around 40 MPa and can hold about 1.8 kg of hydrogen. However, they are expensive to handle and transport. The tube trailers, which consist of several steel cylinders mounted on a protective frame, can be configured to transport from 60 to 450 kg of hydrogen, depending on the number of tubes. This design works well for supplying small amounts of hydrogen, but is very inefficient in terms of energy transported. The weight of the cylinders required is such that the gas only supposes 2 to 4% of the total weight. Liquid hydrogen can be also transported with super insulated double wall containers in order to prevent vaporization problems. In some containers, this liner is filled with liquid nitrogen, which minimizes heat transfer into the tank. The amount of vaporized hydrogen lost to the atmosphere in this type of container is usually between 0.3 and 0.6% per day. The transport of hydrogen gas is normally done at 20 MPa pressure in cylinders with a capacity of about 430 normal cubic meters. The amount of liquid hydrogen transported in a truck is about 4,000 kilograms. This method seems to be the most economical for medium distance transport. On the other hand, the amount of gaseous hydrogen transported in a truck is about 300 kilograms. Therefore, this method seems to be more economical for transport at short distances. As for the maritime transport, sea transport of liquefied hydrogen over long distances seems to be a good alternative. However, the relatively low energy density of liquefied hydrogen requires a higher fraction of liquefied hydrogen compared to natural gas. As far as safety is concerned, the design and construction of liquefied hydrogen tankers would rely on the extensive experience in the transport of liquefied natural gas by sea. It is estimated that the energy consumed by a ship carrying liquefied hydrogen would be between 23 and 38% of the energy of liquefied hydrogen. Currently, there are no ships that can transport pure hydrogen. Such ships will be broadly similar to liquefied natural gas ships and will require the hydrogen to be liquefied prior to transport. While both the ships and the liquefaction process will entail significant cost, a number of projects are actively looking to develop suitable ships, such as the Euro-Quebec project, SWALS, WINET or PORS project. The development of hydrogen refueling station will be one of the most important steps for the widespread use of this new energy source in mobile applications such as fuel cell vehicles. The implementation of hydrogen refueling station should consider the various possible production and logistic scenarios. The first one to be considered is the centralized hydrogen production in large plants or offshore. In this case, the transport of hydrogen to service station could be carried out by network or road, either in liquid form or as compressed gas. The second scenario is a decentralized or distributed hydrogen production or onshore. The current infrastructure, such as natural gas network, electricity network, and pipelines, could be used by installing electrolyzer and reformers from these networks in order to produce hydrogen at the point of supply. Finally, the last case is the onboard hydrogen production, where a reformer will have to be added on board the vehicle itself. The average cost of a hydrogen production and supply station, it is estimated at 4 million of euros. In the next few years, the aim will be to offer robotic service stations that serve hydrogen in just a few minutes using safety valves that prevent leaks when refueling. However, the adaptation of current services stations to the new hydrogen technology is expected to be slow and not free of administrative, political or homologation obstacles. The full cost of hydrogen delivery to end user must take into account all possible stages of the supply chain. The various technologies involved are also at different degrees of maturity, and therefore they have very different future cost reduction potential. The overall cost of delivering hydrogen will vary according to the infrastructure available in the exporting and importing countries, the transmission and distribution distances, the method of transport, and the end-use demand. International Energy Agency analysis suggests that for inland transmission and distribution, hydrogen gas is the cheaper option for distances below around 3,500 km. Above this distance, ammonia pipelines would be the cheaper option, as we can see in the figure. The cheapest source of hydrogen would, however, still be substantially more expensive than natural gas. Although the actual cost differential may be slightly smaller than it looks, because some hydrogen end-use devices may have a higher efficiency than natural gas devices, further cost reduction will be needed to improve the competitiveness of hydrogen against natural gas systems. International Energy Agency analysis indicates that in the future it may be cheaper in a number of instances to import hydrogen than to produce it domestically. Actually, imports of hydrogen produced from renewable electricity appear to make sense for a number of other possible trade routes too. Hydrogen imports could be cheaper than domestic production for a number of countries, especially if ammonia can be used by the final customer without the need for reconversion back into hydrogen. For example, the cost of importing ammonia from electrolytic hydrogen produced in North Africa into Europe could be cheaper than producing it in Europe, as we can see in the figure. However, for many other possible trade routes, the relatively high cost of hydrogen transmission and distribution means that it will generally be cheaper to produce hydrogen domestically rather than import it. This is because the cost of transport will outweigh differences in the cost of electricity production from renewable sources, or differences in natural gas prices and the cost of carbon capture, utilization and storage. In Europe, for example, domestic production of low carbon hydrogen from natural gas equipped with carbon capture, utilization and storage is likely to be cheaper for industry and power application than importing low carbon hydrogen from Russia. With this, we conclude the unit about the different options of hydrogen storage and an overview of the current hydrogen transport and distribution methods. Thank you very much for your attention.